right, testing the microphone here. I just met you, and this is crazy, but here's my number, so call me maybe. Okay, mic's working. Joel, test yours.
Friday, gotta get down on Friday. Partying, yeah. Fun. All right, we're good.
Okay, hello and welcome to the UConn Tonight Show. I'm your host, Jesse Rifkin, and here with me is my sidekick, Joel Frazier. Joel, how's your week been going?
It's been good. The other day, me and my girlfriend made some squirrel feeders. We like took acorns and covered them with peanut butter and rolled busted up acorns in it and found a little burrow of chipmunks. It was adorable.
Great story, Joel. Anyway, a lot's been happening here at UConn, such as a new policy instituted by the undergraduate student government. Can you tell us about that?
That's right, Jesse. The undergraduate student government at UConn has instituted a new policy requiring all student organizations to plan their budgets a whole semester in advance.
Yeah, so now this show needs to know 6 months ahead of time exactly how little money we're going to spend.
How does this show even make money?
How does this show make money? Well, you know, sometimes our guests pay us to end their interviews early.
Yeah. All right, the show.
I don't find that so funny, personally.
It works for me, though. I mean, I usually just pocket it. I don't give it to the show.
Oh. So that's why our show's in debt. Okay. Pay up, man.
All right, well, the show Modern Family, they won an award for Best Television Comedy at the Emmy Awards last Sunday.
Yeah, Modern Family, great show. It's a show about a family that defies traditional stereotypes. Kind of like your family, Joel.
Oh yeah, my dad is black, my mom's white. I look black, not 100% black, but black enough to get into college. So yeah, I see where you're coming from.
Can I make a follow-up racial joke?
Not if you still want to be friends.
Oh, okay, well then I'll move on to another joke. this one's bad. Hey, you'll like this. Or not, I don't know, we haven't done it yet. Maybe he won't. If he doesn't, we'll edit it out. Anyway, J.K. Rowling, her first post-Harry Potter book came out this week. It's entitled The Casual Vacancy. Have you read it, Joel?
I can't read.
Oh yeah, I forgot. Anyway, he says as he's reading off the teleprompter. We should have thought of that before we wrote that joke. Anyway, well, I checked out the book. I was actually kind of disappointed. You know, I knew it was advertised as a book for adults, but I didn't realize it would just be 500 pages of Harry Potter going through his midlife crisis. Yeah, he buys a Corvette, quits his job, marries a much younger woman. Yeah, the movie version's opening in 2045, starring Daniel Radcliffe.
Ginny Weasley must be very sad.
Yeah, but what happened with the main lawn on the campus this week?
The main lawn on campus outside of the student union was officially named this week.
What did they officially name it?
The Great Lawn.
Seriously?
Seriously.
They named it the Great Lawn. Yeah, the other finalists included the Good Field and Acceptable Grass.
There was also This Used to Be Dirt, or there was Quality Ground.
That's not funny. Why would you even say that? Oh, wait, because I wrote the joke. Anyway, anyway, a lot happening with the national election. Joel, tell us about that.
Mitt Romney is catching a lot of controversy over a video was leaked online of him saying he doesn't care about 47% of Americans.
Yeah. You also see the video of him leaked online doing the Gangnam Style dance. It was very out of character. I was very surprised. Usually he outsources the jobs to South Korea. But anyway, yeah, a video leaked online of Mitt Romney basically saying he doesn't care about 47% of Americans. If we didn't care about 47% of our show's viewers, we would be alienating 0.47 people.
Hey, my parents watch it. You know, my mom, my dad, my girlfriends watch it. All my friends watch it.
Really? Hey, cool.
No, that was a joke.
Oh.
Anyway, moving on. Some very interesting news about Nebraska this week.
Go on.
That was another joke.
Let's hope we don't have any viewers at Nebraska.
Of course, let's hope we have viewers at all.
Yeah, Chris is watching from the control room. That's one. Okay, anyway, we have another guest coming up next week. We are very excited. I'm not making this up. Connecticut Governor Daniel Malloy will be our guest on the show next week. Seriously.
I think our first question should be, so how do you enjoy governing?
Not a political science major, I take it.
No way. Are you a political science major?
Yeah, I am, actually. My first question to Governor Malloy was going to be, what is the optimal governmental system by which we may structure society to achieve the ideal balance between protecting civil liberties and societal security?
I'm not sure what that means, but I'm sure that all of the people that accidentally sat on the remote and turned to channel 14 are going to love to hear the answer to that.
Yes, I'm very excited. And then we'll ask him what his favorite food is. Yeah, so stay tuned for that show. But in the meantime, stay tuned for our next two guests. We have a guy named Seth. He's a puppetry major, and he's going to teach us how to do some puppetry. And then we also have the awesome guy, the best guy from the library with the best mustache on campus. Do you agree?
I agree.
Anyway,
that is all.
we'll edit that part out. Anyway, yeah, his name is Nicholas Eshelman, and he'll be stopping by. So stay tuned for more UConn Tonight Show. Hello and welcome back to the UConn Tonight Show. We're welcomed by a very special guest, Cinderella.
So, do you prefer Cindy or Cinderella as a whole?
Well, I think Cinderella sounds better to me. Okay. Rolls off the tongue a little better, don't you think?
I do think so. Hey, I understand you brought another guest of yours.
Oh, yes, I did. Just a second.
Hey guys.
So this is Beast, am I correct?
I am the Beast.
So you prefer the Beast or drop the like Facebook?
The Beast.
Okay.
So Cinderella and Beast, can you tell us, what's your relationship been like?
Oh, well, you know, for the most part, we just kind of hang out in a trunk together.
Wait, no, but sometimes we do shows.
Hey, but not together.
Oh yeah, that's right.
Hey. Who's that other friend you brought with you?
Oh,
well, I think that's the captain down there, don't you think?
Who is she? Well,
hello, Captain.
Hey there.
Good to see you.
Hey, good to see you.
Hey, so do you enjoy eating Captain Crunch cereal?
Honestly, I never had it. We don't get along.
Why? What did Captain Crunch do to you?
Well, he likes those berries, and I don't care for berries. I like them plain.
So what cereal do you eat?
Oh, well, that's a good question. I like the Quaker. Those Quaker Oats, have you ever had those?
I have. They're delicious.
No, I feel like I'm product placing here.
They're paying you $50, right?
He wishes.
At Beast and Cinderella, what kind of products do you enjoy?
Well, that's a good question. I like a good deer. I do eat deer every once in a while.
Well, you eat mice, too, and mice are my friends.
Well, that's true, too. But, you know, what's your favorite thing? What do you eat?
I'm a fan of deer. Venison goes a long way.
You like the Captain Crunch?
Captain Crunch is okay. Mm-hmm. I'm more of a blueberry man myself.
Me? Cinderella?
Yes. What do you like?
I like Cheerios, honey nut Cheerios.
Frosted Cheerios.
Oh, Frosted Cheerios, too.
That's the way to do it.
You ever had Cheerios?
Can't say I have. No, I can't say I have.
Okay. Wait, I understand there's someone beneath the desk, too. Is it... Who's that? It looks like Seth Shaffer, a graduate student in the Puppet Arts Department. Hi.
Hi, nice to meet you.
Hi, nice to meet you here.
Good to see you.
Hi, so you're a graduate student in the Puppet Arts Program?
I am a graduate student in the Puppet Arts Program. And the Puppet Arts Program's been around for a long time, and we do a lot of great stuff. What you see here is actually just a part of the Dick Myers Project, which is the project I am working on this year. Dick Myers was a puppeteer who was very, very well respected in the puppetry community. Jim Henson, who is the founder of the Muppets, himself, he said that Dick Myers was the genius of American puppetry, and yet nothing exists on video. So we are remounting his shows and recording them so that people for generations to come can enjoy his work.
They've never been recorded
They've
before.
Never been recorded.
Wow. So how did your interest in puppetry start? I understand you went to Toledo originally?
Yeah, I grew up in a suburb not too far from Toledo, about 40 minutes from Toledo is where I grew up. And then I studied acting and film at the University of Toledo. And before that, I was touring around the Toledo area with a puppetry group called the Kids on the Block. I started doing that when I was 14 years old. After I graduated from Toledo, I spent a year as a photographer, and then I went on the road with a puppetry troupe out of Cincinnati, Ohio, called Madcap Puppet Theater, and I toured with them for 3 years, and then decided there's more to puppetry than just what I was doing, and I wanted to study more, so that's what drew me here to UConn.
Yeah, most people don't know UConn has a puppet arts program.
Most people don't know that there's a puppet arts program here, and this is the only school in the U.S. that offers 3 degrees in puppetry, a BFA, an MA, and an MFA.
Oh, wow.
Wow.
The only other school, there's a, you can get a degree out at Cal Arts, which is a private university, and then also at West Virginia, you can get a BFA in puppetry.
You know, I'm a political science major here at the university, so if you combine your puppetry major and my political science major, you get a puppet regime.
It's a bad joke.
Oh.
That's okay.
we'll add a laugh track. All right, so which is harder, the puppetry or the voices?
And that really does depend. These voices I just kind of came up with while I was sitting there. And so usually when you're working on a voice in a character, mm-hmm. you're sitting a long time working on it. Since Dick Myers shows were performed reel-to-reel tapes, all the voices already exist. So I'm going to be performing and manipulating the puppets, but not voicing them in the shows. So I haven't really given them voices yet. So I'm down here thinking, okay, what would he sound like? Okay, what would he sound like? But at the same time, it does take a lot of work, and it does take a lot of commitment to a specific voice. But at the same time, it takes a lot of work and a lot of commitment to figure out how to manipulate the puppets. And every puppet's completely different.
And we understand you have a puppet with you that shows
the mechanism,
how that works.
Yeah. Now, this is a demonstration puppet that Dick Myers had created. And in it, you can see how all these complex rods are inside there. And these knobs down here will control the heads to look back and forth. I'm just going back and forth mm-hmm. with my hand. And then as I lift up and down on it, it makes the head look up and down. And then with the feet, there's another rocker bar that I can just swing back and forth and make the feet walk. And the arms, I just have a cable I pull down on, and it lifts the arms up. And Dick Myers, he was really known for his simplicity in puppetry. And you can see this is very, very complex, but they look very simple when you see him performing on stage because he did such a great job of creating a complex puppet.
What's the best reaction you've gotten when you told people you're a puppetry major?
Oh, I don't know how many reactions can go on TV.
this show isn't censored.
The good thing about puppetry in America is, you know, with Jim Henson and his work with the Muppets, a lot of times what I'll get is, oh, like Kermit the Frog, or oh, like Miss Piggy, is the reaction of what kind of puppetry you do. Then you say, well, there's so much more to puppetry than just, you know, the hand and mouth, I'm going to flap my gums, puppetry. These puppets, there was a lot of music, a lot of dancing, and not as much talking in his shows. And Jim Henson himself called it the genius of American puppetry. So it tells you that you don't just have to have, you know, opening and closing mouth. You can have all kinds of wonderful mm-hmm. things happen in puppetry.
How long does it take to produce a puppet show?
On average, expect to spend close to a year working on a project between your conceptions to the script. Now, that's a short time frame. Sometimes, as in the case of Dick Myers, it took 2 years for him to put his shows together. But a lot of times it'll start with a concept. We are, you know, if you think about post-dramaticism, where, you know, stories come off of a concept, we, in puppetry, have been doing that for generations. We haven't been finding scripts to adapt. We've been thinking of a concept and then, you know, going from there and creating scripts from that.
And we understand you're working with, like, a very interesting project, your thesis, I believe.
Yeah, and that's what we see right here is the Dick Myers project. So I've been studying Dick Myers for about a year and a half now, learning who he was. There really hasn't been much written about him. I could put what has been written about him in books and probably a 4 or 5 page pamphlet. Mm-hmm. And other than that, the whole extent of my research has been interviews and talking to people, finding letters he wrote to other people, and then kind of tracking his journey and where he was. Dick Myers was one of the only puppeteers to ever perform in Russia during the Cold War, as far as an American puppeteer goes. And he was invited there, and it was this wonderful experience for him.
What show did he perform there?
He performed Cinderella there, I believe, yeah. And so there's Cinderella right here. And he also performed Cinderella in Geneva. He performed it in Charleville. So he performed it in all these great places across Europe. And he also performed in Japan for a while, which was quite a hip experience for him.
I believe in Russia they changed the title to Cinderellovich.
Cinderellovich.
Is Cinderella her first or her last name?
Cinderella's her first name.
Does she have a last name?
That's a good question.
Jones?
I'll have to reread Cinderella, the script. Cinderella, I haven't read it for a long time.
It's Cinderella, Cinderella.
Cinderella, Cinderella. And you can also see some of the Dick Myers puppets on display at the Ballard Institute and Museum of Puppetry. We have a couple of them on display right there right now, as well as a bunch of other puppets, a lot of great puppets from across America. There's currently a shadow puppet exhibit from China that is absolutely gorgeous, and I recommend going out and checking that out, too.
What are puppets like in other parts of the world? Do they differ significantly from American puppets?
Yes and no. I mean, you know, we think of America as the great American melting pot. We take everything, a little bit of culture
USA.
From here, a
USA.
Little culture from there, a little culture from there. Nothing is very distinctly American when it comes to puppetry or when it comes to most things in the arts or in the, you know, in general. But what we do is we pull a little bit from there, a little bit from here, a little bit from this culture, that culture, that culture, and create something new that's, you know, nice and homogenous, where it's like everything melding together and melting in a pot. So. Yeah.
Wow. So what year are you in the program right now?
This is my third year graduate year. So as a graduate, you do 2 years of classes, and then your third year, you work on a specific project. And that's what I'm working on right here, is the Dick Myers project.
And then after this, you go on to what, like Avenue Q or something?
it really depends. A lot of people who work for or get the degree will go and open their own company and start doing that. We've had people that worked for Sesame Street. We've had people work on Avenue Q. In fact, one of the alumni helped design parts of Avenue Q, which is really hip. And there's a lot of different things. And you don't... Have you ever seen Spider-Man 2?
No.
Well, you know Dr. Octopus in Spider-Man 2?
Oh, wait, yes. Yes. Yes.
You know, Dr. Octopus, when it wasn't CGI, was actually an alumni from UConn that was doing the puppetry for the Dr. Octopus costume.
Really?
Yep.
That's and so, amazing.
And he learned a lot of the skills from here on how to build that. And then, you know, he adapted, you know, to whatever else needed to happen to make it for film.
The next person that we're interviewing on our show is famous for his... mustache. He has a very intricate mustache you might see around campus. You, I see, have full facial hair. What do you think the is there like a war between mustache and bearded men, or is it
that's an interesting question. I when I first met my wife, she did not want me to have facial hair at all. And then I got cast as in a show where I had to grow a full beard, and I was playing Aesop from Aesop's Fables. And so I grew this big beard, and then she ended up liking it so much she hasn't let me shave it off completely.
Well, that's great. Well, you are a very good puppeteer. I look forward to seeing your work. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
To have you. And great to have you here, Cinderella and Beast and Admiral.
Well, it's good to have them all on the show, too. So.
Tell them to come back. I don't know if we'll ever have you back. But
that's all right.
You were okay. They were great, though.
They were great, yeah. Okay. And you can see these guys at the Ballard Institute sometime soon, too. So.
Right,
well, I think I just might. And stay tuned. We'll be right back with more UConn Tonight Show.
All right.
Cool. Great, guys. That was awesome.
Awesome.
Down goes Tony.
to the editor, which says, a column by a certain Jesse Rifkin this week recommended that the classroom building be renamed after the guy in the library with the awesome mustache. Skips the line, I am that guy.
Yeah.
Ready? Okay, we're rolling. Hello and welcome back to the UConn Tonight Show. My guest tonight, most of you probably don't know his name, but hopefully all of you should recognize his face. He's popularly known around campus as the guy in the library with the awesome mustache, but here we are, and he is with us today, Mr. Nicholas Eshelman. Great to have you here.
Thank you. Great Joel.
So when did you first grow your awesome facial hair?
Well, I think I started about 4 years ago, for no reason in particular, just because I was bored. And for a long time I had a standard goatee, which is pretty boring. And I don't know, I was just sitting around one night and I thought, well, let's see what I can do. And I can't really grow hair on the side of my face. I could never grow a full beard. I just get something that kind of looks like Bob Dylan's armpit. And that's not very appealing. So I tried.
Smell. It doesn't smell.
No. And so I tried a lot.
And when it talks, you can never understand what it's saying.
No, you can't. So anyway, I tried a lot of different styles, and I brought some pictures to show you what I went through before I settled on this. This one's sort of my favorite. It's a hybrid between a mustache and kind of a goatee. So it's not a true mustache if you're particular about those things.
Okay, so you brought along a few pictures of your mustache in earlier stages.
Yeah, so this one.
Hold it up to a camera here.
This one?
Sure.
I called the beardo weirdo. Again, it was sort of a hybrid mustache and goatee. This one, obviously, is your classic neck beard. And I wasn't real happy with that. I kept it for a bit. This is the redneck beard. It's the same as the neck beard.
In order to see this picture, you have to be at least 21.
It's the same as the neck beard, except there's a jug and I'm wearing hillbilly bib overalls. Mm-hmm. This one I call The Fight Inside of Me, after my favorite Merle Haggard song. This is El Gancho, The Hook, for obvious reasons. This is the quadrastache. It's hard to achieve the quadra stash. It doesn't really hold up well in humid weather. And this is El Capitan, because I think I look pretty bad. and finally, we have the catfish.
The catfish.
Yeah. And I have done others, but, you know, those are the ones that I think sort of turned out the best.
What does your wife think?
Oh, my wife's completely supportive of it. I actually was kind of inspired by my wife to grow silly mustaches, not because she has a mustache, but she loves, my wife, who also works here on campus, loves fashion and clothing, and she's an excellent seamstress. And so, you know, she just likes to dress the way she likes to dress, and she dresses very creatively. And, you know, I can't make my own clothes, but,
you can grow your own face clothes.
I can grow a, yes, I can, so. That's sort of why I do it.
So you can wear clothes in the winter?
Well, no, just so I can. It's not self-expression, but it's just, you know, I think everyone should look the way they want to look. You know, if you want to have a silly mustache, if you want to have a tattoo, whatever.
So what's the best reaction you've gotten?
Somebody asked me if it was real. I thought that was pretty good.
And what did you say?
I said, yeah, it's real. I mean, you know, I didn't have a snappy comeback for that, but I get good reactions.
Your reaction should have been, actually, it's silicone. I went to a guy in Beverly Hills.
Yeah, but, you know, I wasn't thinking. I don't have your quick wit. But little kids always have good reactions, because they'll just point, you know, and then their parents will go, don't do that.
So what's your secret to the curl?
Well, it's a complex process. I begin with some hair goop that my wife recommended. And once the hair goop has dried, I curl it with curling iron. And depending on the humidity level, like today I used a narrow barrel because when it's humid, it tends to droop. But if it were going to be dry out, I could use a larger, maybe 1 inch in diameter barrel, and I would have larger curls. And then I use a hairspray. Okay. So it's a three-step process.
Okay.
So you're always in the library. What is your actual position with the university?
Well, I...
Think about it.
I'd give you my title, but the title's sort of meaningless. I do system administration, Linux system administration, computer security, and just a variety of miscellaneous other IT tasks.
Okay, so, but everybody on campus knows you. You're like a local celebrity.
Well, that's very pleasing to know.
Okay, so whose beard or mustache, facial hair in general, do you model yourself after? Who's your idol, if you will?
Well, I think everyone's idol in the mustache world is Raleigh Fingers. He pitched for the Oakland A's in the late 70s, and he had an excellent, true handlebar mustache. And Raleigh was a man of great principle. So when his career with the A's was nearing an end, he had a couple more good years in him, and he thought, well, you know, I could keep pitching somewhere else. And he got an offer from the Reds, which at the time was run by Marge Schott, who was a horrible, horrible person. And this will illustrate
with
why.
No excellent mustache whatsoever.
Don't say that out loud. He's our guest after you.
And we got a Reds fan around here, or a Marge Schott defender. Anyway, Marge said, well, Raleigh, you know, you can come pitch for us, but you have to shave your mustache. So Raleigh just retired.
Do you have a favorite fictional character mustache or beard?
Well, I guess my wife likes to watch Hercule Poirot on TV. You know, the Belgian, there's an Agatha Christie character, and he's a portly little Belgian man. And he actually has a very tidy mustache. It's nothing spectacular.
Have you ever considered entering any contests like the Coney Island Beard and Mustache Contest?
I, at this point, don't feel that my mustache is competition quality.
Really?
No, I don't. If you look at photographs from the either the international competitions, which have the most impressive level of competitor, or even the regional ones, I'm not even close. I'd be blown out of the water.
Who won international?
I don't know. It's usually a European. It's often a German or an Austrian. They seem to have a long tradition of silly facial hair.
But what kind of facial hair do they have? Do they?
Oh, all kinds of crazy things. So if you would imagine the quadrastache times 8, and this big.
What's the prefix for 32?
I don't know.
The ox quadrastache.
Sounds good. 32-o-stache.
My roommate is a bearded man, a very bearded man.
Yeah?
Like, full beard about down to here, full mustache, and he has a thing where he licks his mustache or beard. Are there any like weird things that you might find yourself doing with your mustache throughout the day, just kind of out of habit?
No, I'd have to say that licking your beard or mustache is very weird.
There you go, Matt.
Yeah.
It's been settled.
Yes. Sorry, dude. No, I don't think so. I just let it sit there.
Okay.
Well, thank you so much for stopping by the show.
Certainly.
I must say, you make Joel and myself and basically every other male on this campus feel like less of a man.
I don't believe. I mean, if you feel like less of a man because of a librarian, you got a problem.
Thank you for stopping by.
Good to meet you guys.
And we'll be right back with more UConn Tonight Show.